Most cities have originated as trading outposts or forts. But Washington, D.C. originated with a vision, the vision of a new nation's capital as a work of classical civic art that would impart solemnity and grandeur to the founders' bold venture in Republican government. Of the nation's 15 best-loved buildings, ranked in a 2007 American Institute of Architects poll, no fewer than six are expressions of that classical vision: the White House, the U.S. Capitol, the Jefferson and Lincoln Memorials, the Washington Monument, and the Supreme Court. So too is the city's great monumental axis, the Mall. This is the story of that vision, which, despite its splendid achievements, has sometimes been forgotten or ignored even in our own day. On the cusp of our capital city's third century, Americans can and should resolve to restore and renew it once again. How did the vision come to be? Article 7, Section 8 of the Constitution called for the creation of a new federal district to serve as the seat of government. In 1790, George Washington was inaugurated, and the Residence Act was approved by Congress. It specified that the government, by 1800, be permanently located somewhere along a 66-mile stretch of the Potomac River. The designated area was at the time centrally located, giving all states equal access to it by land and sea, and from it, access to the West. As prescribed by the Residence Act, Washington chose the exact site, which lay on the Potomac in what is now known as the Anacostia River. On September 9, 1791, Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, and the city commissioners appointed by Washington met and named the new capital the Territory of Columbia, and the territory's new government center, Washington. But who possessed the knowledge, breadth of vision, energy, and boldness needed to implant a new capital on this unruly, sparsely settled terrain? The man who came to the president's attention was Pierre Charles L'Enfant, former major of engineers in the Continental Army, wounded in battle at Savannah. A native of France, the eldest son of an accomplished painter and instructor at the Royal Academy, L'Enfant had received a rigorous education that included training in the arts. He understood the task at hand, asserting that the plan for the new capital
must leave to posterity a grand idea of the patriotic interest that promoted it.
Aware of L'Enfant's design talents and technical skills, Washington was confident he had found the right candidate. To assist L'Enfant, Maryland surveyor Andrew Ellicott was engaged to map the site of the new capital. Washington, a surveyor in his early years, understood what both men were doing and often accompanied them. L'Enfant identified a high point, Jenkins Hill,
a pedestal waiting for a monument,
as the site for the Capitol building. A mile from Jenkins Hill, he sighted the president's house on a low ridge overlooking the Potomac. Jefferson, who had served as minister to Paris, furnished L'Enfant with plans of European cities. Washington had never visited Europe, but he understood the siting of buildings and the creation of vistas, as he had demonstrated in planning his Mount Vernon estate. As for L'Enfant, landscape elements were more central to his Washington plan than was typical of European city plans. Nor was he content with the simple gridiron layouts routine for new American towns. In L'Enfant's ambitious design, the Capitol building would face west across a broad mall toward a heroic equestrian statue of Washington and the Potomac beyond. The mall would be landscaped with trees, statuary, and fountains. The president's house would face south across a green ellipse to the Washington statue site and the Potomac. Radiating from the Capitol building and the President's house, diagonal avenues stretched across the street grid, creating squares or circles at key junctures. L'Enfant intended his avenues to visually reduce distances, provide contrast with the narrower streets in the grid, and bind the city together. Between February 1791 and February 1792, L'Enfant not only completed the formidable task of drawing the plan of a great city, he guided surveying for the plan, saw construction of the President's House and Capitol building get underway, and began staking out and clearing city streets, avenues, squares, and circles. L'Enfant's quarrels with the city commissioners soon led to his dismissal, but Washington later wrote,
"I have no hesitation in declaring that it has always been my invariable opinion, and remains still to be so, that no departure from the engraved plan of the city ought to be allowed."
No founder, in short, grasped the richness and breadth of L'Enfant's vision more deeply than George Washington. In 1812, Americans again went to war against Britain, whose forces captured Washington and burned both the Capitol building and the President's house. L'Enfant's vision, nonetheless, survived in the city's layout and in those two buildings, where Reconstruction began immediately. But it was neglected in most respects. For years, the Capitol and the White House, a name that soon replaced President's House, were the only major government buildings in Washington. It wasn't until 1836 that architect Robert Mills erected near the White House the 15th Street wing of the Treasury building with its stately Ionic colonnade. Then came Mills's massive patent office, now home to Smithsonian Institution Museums of American Art, and the nearby General Post Office building. Like the Treasury, both buildings were severe in style, yet they reaffirmed in stone, even as they rose among scattered structures of frame or brick, the grand scale and substance of Washington as the founders envisioned it. Mills also had a hand in the design of the Washington Monument, the soaring obelisk begun in 1848, but not completed until 1885, at the site where L'Enfant had suggested an equestrian statue of Washington. The monument reinforced the mall axis, extending from the Capitol building, as well as the cross axis, extending from the White House. These axes would later be extended by the Lincoln and Jefferson memorials. Thomas Eustace Walter of Philadelphia was meanwhile adding spacious new House and Senate wings to the Capitol building. The base of a great central dome was in place by 1856, and construction progressed until the Civil War forced a temporary halt. But Abraham Lincoln ordered the resumption of work in 1862, and the dome's titanic armature took shape as thousands of tons of cast iron were lifted and bolted into place. On December 1, 1863, with a large crowd watching, the head of the Statue of Freedom at the summit of the superbly proportioned dome was hoisted into place. Crowning its Jenkins Hill pedestal, just as Washington and L'Enfant had envisioned, the United States Capitol became on that day in 1863 the supreme architectural symbol of the American democracy. The expanded Capitol building is one of the most magnificent manifestations of the founders' vision with which Washington has been blessed. And yet, by the time the expansion was complete, Pierre Charles L'Enfant's plan had been totally forgotten. 3 decades later, Washington architect Glenn Brown was researching a history of the Capitol building when he uncovered the plan. Steeped in admiration, Brown made the L'Enfant plan's regeneration his cause. He had ample justification, for the great plan's descent into oblivion had had dismal consequences. What Brown saw on the Mall at the close of the 19th century included a gas plant, a lumber yard, a tangle of electrical lines, and even a couple of railway stations. And in contrast, say, to the many architectural delights in the vicinity of the Louvre in Paris, L'Enfant's Mall was abutted by flophouses, saloons, and assorted squalor. Around the time he uncovered the L'Enfant plan, Brown traveled to Chicago for the World's Columbian Exposition. As the guest of Daniel Burnham, Chicago architect and chief of construction for the fair, Brown toured the vast assemblage of monumental classical buildings. With its landscaped greens and blue lagoons, the 1893 exposition exceeded all expectations, attracting over 27 million visitors, the equivalent of about half the nation's population at the time. The fair's cultural impact was likewise immense. It ushered in the City Beautiful movement and changed the face of urban America, starting with the city of Washington. Because the L'Enfant Plan and the Chicago Exposition sprung from the same classical roots, the tremendous success of the latter could only encourage the restoration of the former. As the centennial of the transfer of the nation's capital to Washington approached, Brown brought the forgotten plan to the attention of friends and colleagues, including Charles Moore, a well-connected, immensely energetic aide to Senator James McMillan of Michigan. McMillan chaired the U.S. Senate's District of Columbia Committee. Brown also managed to key the 1900 convention of the American Institute of Architects to the centennial festivities. He organized lectures on Washington by nationally known architects, historians, landscape architects, sculptors, and artists. Since governors, mayors, and the national press were in town for the festivities, the lecturers were assured an influential audience. At the convention's conclusion, the AIA declared, "The location and grouping of public buildings, the ordering of landscape and statuary, and the extension of the park system in the District of Columbia are matters of national concern and should be made in accordance with a comprehensive artistic scheme." The organization requested creation of a federal commission to generate such a scheme. Thanks largely to the cultural impact of the Chicago Exposition, support for this proposal quickly coalesced around the country. Senator McMillan was unable to obtain congressional funding for the commission recommended by the AIA. Fortunately for Washington's future, McMillan was a shrewd and determined parliamentarian. He secured a Senate resolution allowing his District of Columbia committee to seek professional advice for, quote, plans for the development and improvement of the entire park system, unquote, of the nation's capital. The mall was, of course, the centerpiece of that system. McMillan then selected a special commission to be chaired by Charles Moore, which consisted of the distinguished architects Daniel Burnham and Charles Fallon McKim, the landscape architect Frederick Law Olmsted Jr., son of the co-designer of Manhattan Central Park, and the sculptor Augustus St. Gaudens. Internationally known and revered for their work at the Chicago Fair and elsewhere, all of the design professionals on the commission agreed to serve on a pro bono basis. Appointed in March 1901, the commission conveyed its report, which was written by Moore, to McMillan on January 15, 1902. In presenting that report to the Senate, McMillan observed that
the original plan of the city of Washington, having stood the test of a century, has met universal approval. The departures from that plan are to be regretted and, wherever possible, remedied. The object of the present investigation is to prepare for the city of Washington such a plan as shall enable future development to proceed along the lines originally planned, namely, the treatment of the city as a work of civic art.
The study, later known as the McMillan Plan, built on the L'Enfant Plan. One of its most important features was the extension of the mall axis to the Lincoln Memorial site. This was made possible by a massive Army Corps of Engineers earth-moving operation that had created hundreds of acres of new infill on what had previously been Potomac River tidal flats. In L'Enfant's day, the riverbank was scarcely more than a stone's throw from the Washington Monument site. The McMillan Commission also produced models, drawings, and photographs, which were exhibited at the Corcoran Gallery near the White House. President and Mrs. Theodore Roosevelt came to view the exhibition and discussed the plan with its authors. Senator McMillan died in 1902. Though Congress never formally adopted the plan he made possible, it was widely publicized and its advocates were tireless. In 1908, Glenn Brown arranged for L'Enfant's body to be moved from an obscure Maryland grave to Arlington National Cemetery, where it was reinterred at a site overlooking the city he had envisioned. 3 years later, a tabletop marker engraved with his plan of Washington was erected over the grave. President William Howard Taft attended the dedication. By that time, Taft had signed a law creating the Commission of Fine Arts to provide government officials with advice on
the location of statues, fountains, and monuments in the public squares, streets, and parks of the District of Columbia.
Narrowly defined at first, the commission's authority was subsequently expanded. At long last, there was a federal agency in a position to uphold L'Enfant's legacy and assure broad adherence to the McMillan Plan. In 1924, Congress created the forerunner of today's National Planning Commission, which also was charged with implementing the plan. The McMillan Plan received its supreme validation with the approval in 1912 of Henry Bacon's design for the Lincoln Memorial. A bitter fight over the memorial had lasted more than a decade, with alternative schemes and sites proposed by other architects. Bacon's memorial at the west end of the mall was dedicated in 1922. A great public spectacle was mounted the following year, with special lighting, music, banners, and a barge trip down the reflecting pool to the steps of the memorial for Henry Bacon. Yet the prevalence of classicism in the design of public buildings, a legacy of the great Chicago Exposition both in the nation's capital and in the nation at large, was by the 1930s under attack from a growing cadre of modernist critics. Even as the Federal Triangle Complex, with its august porticos, wealth of pedimental structure, and abundance of fine detail, was being built, an undercurrent of apprehension pervaded the scene, Charles Moore later recalled. The Federal Triangle is the last and largest of the nation's great classical ensembles. After the Lincoln Memorial, it ranks as the McMillan Plan's most significant architectural result. In A Quest for Grandeur, her 1993 book about the triangle, architecture historian Sally Crest Tompkins observed, "Although accused of sterility, the Federal Triangle buildings seem bold and fascinating compared to what was to follow. But perhaps most important, the people who use these buildings like them and have pride in them." But a dramatic change in elite sentiment was reflected in the opposition of the Commission of Fine Arts to John Russell Pope's Jefferson Memorial design. President Franklin Delano Roosevelt saw to it that the memorial, along with Pope's magnificent National Archives building and the Federal Triangle, were erected according to the architect's plans. Still, the tide was turning. When Pope's National Gallery of Art was completed in 1941, it was mordantly dismissed by critics as the last of the Romans. And in fact, no classical building of this importance has been erected in Washington since. Modernism as an ideology opposed to traditional art had come of age in Europe after World War I, partly in reaction to the horrific human toll taken by that conflict and to the hardship brought on by the Great Depression. After World War II, it became the default option for institutional architecture all over the world. Its triumph seemed both inevitable and unquestionable. Today, the situation is different, and Americans can take the measure of what two generations of modernist hegemony have wrought, and of what modernism supplanted. Washington's post-war federal office buildings typically amount to visual deserts, inside and out. Ornament and indeed beauty have been banished with religious fervor. The ponderous Forrestal building hovers oppressively over a no-man's land below. The FBI's J. Edgar Hoover headquarters building is a concrete behemoth, seemingly imported from another planet and plopped down across Pennsylvania Avenue from the Triangle, without the slightest regard for its urban context. High up, cantilevered offices loom ominously over anyone who dares pass underneath. On the Mall, that once reviled last of the Romans, now known as the National Gallery West Building, has been vindicated by time. Its serene, ordered horizontality, aesthetic refinement, and solid construction have endeared it to the public. Infinitely more controversial is the gallery's East Building, designed by I.M. Pei. The East Building features a bewildering plan of misshapen concourses, cramped galleries, and flat blank walls. A mere three decades after its completion, its exterior was found to require reconstruction, costing an estimated $85 million. Down the Mall, the Hirshhorn Modern Art Museum, resembling a gun turret, leaves one confused as to where, how, or if one is to enter. It makes a rude neighbor to the elegant Freer Gallery of Asian Art. Memorials have also suffered under the modernist hegemony. At the Lincoln Memorial, one mounts a grand stair and passes through a giant colonnade to find enshrined inside a Doric temple the colossal figure of the martyred president in a grave and melancholy half-light, his seated pose expressing his intellectual and literary powers. He gazes east toward the sun's rising over the Capitol dome he completed to proclaim that the Union would endure. Nearby, Franklin Roosevelt sits next to his dog, unelevated either literally or metaphorically by a pedestal. This threadbare sculpture brazenly ignores the classical point of view expressed by John Quincy Adams. Neither dignity nor authority can be supported in human minds without splendor and majesty in some degree apportioned to them. The founder's vision of Washington has been compromised of late by more than misguided aesthetics. Technology has brought on changes undreamt of by Washington, L'Enfant, or the McMillan commissioners. The latter could hardly foresee that the rich man's toy of 1900, the automobile, would become every man's necessity during the 20th century. After World War II, this would lead to the elimination of Washington's extensive and popular trolley system, insatiable demand for parking, and urban expressways that tore neighborhoods apart. A metro subway system, while successful in moving people, has not always been successful in creating urbane places. Commercial pressures are also a threat. There is a recurring clamor in favor of scrapping Washington's height limit. This would make way for skyscrapers, such as those visible across the Potomac, that would obscure the legibility and hierarchy of the Washington skyline, dwarfing the Capitol building and other important monuments. Our founding fathers envisioned in what was largely a wilderness on the Potomac, a classical city, adorned with magnificent public buildings that, as Washington put it,
in sight, form, and elegance must look beyond the present day.
As we have seen, that vision was compromised over the city's first 100 years by radical changes in technology and economic activity, as well as commercial pressures and aesthetic confusion. Today, on the threshold of Washington's third century, similar forces are again working to obscure the founder's vision. As with our predecessors a century ago, it is incumbent upon us to restore the L'Enfant plan by recalibrating it to the new demands of our day. As the ranks of classically trained artists and architects increase, plans that accord with the vision of L'Enfant and the founders are once again emerging. By building on its great classical heritage, Washington will continue to serve not only as an inspiration to all Americans, but also as a model for the building and rebuilding of cities and towns all across our land.